over the next couple of weeks, even though it's a book that should be looked at and read in its entirety, we're going to look at Ruth. The book of Ruth is located in the Ketuvim, or the writing section of the Hebrew scriptures. It's a narrative that's told with simplicity and beauty over four chapters, and is widely recognized as an excellent literary achievement of ancient Israel. Like all books in the Hebrew scriptures, and indeed in many of the ancient Near Eastern literary texts, there seems to be very little interest in revealing who the author is. Also, when it comes to dating, in relation to Ruth, we've got those who place the book within the monarchic period because of the book's concluding with the Davidic genealogy. Others place the book in the post-exilic period as a response to the Ezra and Nehemiah reforms that prohibited intermarriage and forced Israelite men to expel foreign wives. Still others suggest it was written during David's lifetime as an apology for his kingship. But rather than spend a whole sermon on the dating, because we seriously could, I think it's fair to say that we've got no certainty to when the book was actually written. But what we do know is that Ruth is set in the context of the Israelite patriarchal society. Ruth is also one of only two books within the Hebrew scriptures that bears a woman's name. It's described as unique in that it celebrates one woman's love for and devotion to another, and as a narrative that radically overturns so many cultural mores. The book opens up and immediately introduces us to this backdrop of suffering and continues to express the tragedy of one family. We're told that a man, his wife and two sons flee from famine of the ironically named Bethlehem, which is, in the Hebrew is lechem, which means bread or food, and then go to seek refuge in the country of Moab. The family is then named. We've got the man, Elimelech. Then we've got Naomi, his wife, and sons, Mahlon and Kilion. And interestingly, the sons are described as his, not theirs. Naomi's maternity isn't established until after the tragedy begins to unfold further, as we hear of Elimelech's death. We're told that the sons took Moabite wives named Orpah and Ruth. And this tragedy deepens as we hear that both sons died, leaving the three women widowed and childless. Such women in this ancient Near Eastern society were viewed as worthless and on the margins. They've been plunged into a significantly vulnerable status in society. I actually came across a couple of readings that linked Ruth to Job, yet I felt that in doing so, what we do is we continue to do the old traditional thing and we wrap this text up in patriarchy and miss the richness of the narrative that unfolds before us. So I just want to pause here, to take a breath, and invite you to take a look at the land in which they seek refuge, and share the interesting week I've had learning a bit of Hebrew. So Moab. This was a kingdom that was often at war with the kingdom of Israel. The Moabites were descendants of Moab, the son of Lot and his oldest daughter, born through incest with her father. And so in general, the Moabites were hated by the Israelites and usually associated with either hostility or sexual perversity. And then Moabite women pose double trouble in the Hebrew scriptures, for not only are they female, they're also foreigner. This term foreigner poses a problem of identity, and so invites in the categories of self and other. Employing these categories was a tool used to identify what an Israelite is and what an Israelite was normal. And interestingly, it suggested that the construction of masculinity or maleness in the Hebrew scriptures relates to the construction of Israelite identity, while femininity and femaleness relates to the construction of Moabite identity. Anywho, back to the Hebrew journey this week. If you cast your mind back to the beginning of the month, we took a brief journey through looking at marriage in the ancient world. And in the Revelation, we found out that it was very easy for things to get lost in translation. The Hebrew, Ish-sha, is translated as both woman and wife. Ish, as both man and husband. The final decision in relation to identify of whether the character is in the narrative is woman or wife or husband and man was left completely in the hands of the English interpreter, translator. In relation to marriage, we're called to remember that there was no single Hebrew word that equates to marriage. The general term, English term, that was used is to take a wife. And here's where it got a bit interesting, because the Hebrew used in the case of Naomi's sons is nasar, which unlike the term yikar, which indicates a consensual action, nasar indicates abduction or forced marriage. And so on learning this, I just became even more enthralled with this ancient book. As Naomi prepares to return to Judah, she recognizes that the best future for Orpah and Ruth is to set them free. To allow them, indeed she implores them to return to their mother's house. In light of this textual interpretation and the fact that it seems these women were abducted or forced into marriage, you know, we can't help surely but think, go, be free. But yet both women refuse. So Naomi goes on to speak the hard truth. She says she's got no sons to marry them. And remember, in this society and world, there were only two ways that women could be valued. And those ways were as an unmarried virgin in her father's household, or as a child-producing wife in her husband's household. Together they wept. Orpah says nothing more. She kissed Naomi and she left, but Ruth clung to her. In this ancient world, Ruth's choice at that moment to remain becomes a choice to be one worthless woman, joining herself to another, refusing to accept the status quo which limits and defines their existence as worthless, empty, and marginal, which was based on marital status or reproductive ability. The journey then begins with a dialogue between Naomi and Ruth, another unique aspect in this narrative. Presumably, women in the ancient world did speak to one another, but this is the only place within scripture that a conversation between two women is recorded and not erased that has no concern for a man. Concern is purely for each other's welfare. We become witnesses to a deep love between two women. Ruth's beautiful, emotional-filled words are words today that are still heard at weddings, yet here they are Ruth's cross-generational, cross-tribal, and cross-religion pledge to her mother-in-law, not her husband. Ruth's commitment to God, of the God of Israel, may not seem anything particularly radical because we're so accustomed to this monotheistic world. And it becomes even more poignant when we hear it in light of the Shema that we heard, the Shema Yisrael in the Gospel reading. Because this is all set in the context of a polytheistic world. In her deep commitment to her mother-in-law, Ruth becomes other. She becomes a refugee in a land where she would be unwelcome and very likely despised. In this male-dominated system, we witness their determination to care for and support each other. Their self-determination is expressed in their refusal to accept the marginalized status that is based on a heterosexual, patriarchal definition of marriage, family, and procreation. Ruth and Naomi's story is one that is repeated throughout history, because more often than not, it's women who are displaced. Here in Australia, women aged 45 and over are currently recognised as the fastest growing group of homeless people. In August 2020, it was identified that some 400,000 women were at risk of homelessness. And then I want to move to consider the potential that Ruth was abducted and forced into marriage, because we must acknowledge and accept that this continues to be an issue in our world today. According to UNICEF, one in every five girls is married or in union before reaching the age of 18, with that number doubling in the least developed countries. The result is that women and girls attempt to flee seeking safety or commit suicide to avoid or escape from marriage. So in relation to Ruth's refugee status, we must ask, how would she be treated if she were to arrive in Australia? And I know that when I've been to Baita, I've met young girls that have escaped forced marriage. Would we place Ruth in detention? After all, she was a Canaanite who spoke some variety of Arabic. Would she be seen as a threat? These two women are traveling together without a man. Would they be viewed by contempt by some? They may, after all, be lesbians. Ruth and Naomi, in their mutual vulnerability, rather than becoming weaker, are strengthened by their relationship with one another. God moves in subversion of what culture names as security and power. This beautiful story of loving kindness and loyalty becomes a poignant and powerful story of strength and determination. I believe it calls us to consider what our responsibility is within our context, which is one where we continue to see the artificial barriers based on gender and sexuality and where you come from are constructed. We live in the now and not yet of the kingdom of God. And in our commitment as disciples of Jesus, we're called to work for a society that breaks through the artificial barriers that have been constructed. Those artificial barriers that prevent the bringing about of true justice and peace. The barriers that prevent the fullness and flourishing of life for all. I hear the call that we must read and reread the beautiful stories of the writings in the scriptures and recognize the depth and relevance for us today, and to hear the words of blessing, creed, and poem, and to hear the declaration that offers us new ways in which we can relate to one another. Let's pray. Sacred mystery, Shekinah. All praise to you as you break down the barriers that divide. Breathe your spirit upon us to work as the presence of Jesus in our world and communities. May we be love in a world divided by hate and derision. May we be